Right now, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I hope all of you are doing well. Today's session 14 of this pre-webinar series, we have on microgreens on demand. Actually, quite a number of people have been asking because, you know, many of them avoid gardening because they have to get messy, you know, working in the mud. So microgreen is a very good answer for all those who like to start off with gardening without messing up their hands, dirtying their hands in mud. And for this special episode, I have a special guest. Please mute. Participants, please mute. Attendees. Yeah. So I have a special guest from Bangalore. We have Arkesh Shenoy, a 19-year-old BSc agriculture student. After a power-packed session by Trisha last week, we have another student this time. And Arkesh is very interesting. Please mute. Ladies and gentlemen, please mute. Arkesh is a 19-year-old BSc agriculture student, a nature enthusiast, nature photographer, and his special interests are microgreens. He's been doing microgreens for quite a long time. Apart from this, what's interesting is he is heavily into rehabilitation of butterflies. He has rescued about 700 butterflies in the last few months and years. So we have Arkesh, and I don't want to take any more of your time. I'd like to hand over to Arkesh. Arkesh, are you there? Arkesh, can you hear me, Arkesh?
I am right here.
Yeah, okay, welcome, Arkesh. Welcome. Over to you, Arkesh.
Hi. Yes. Hello, everyone. It's Arkesh here. I'm very happy to be here today to share what I know about microgreens to all of you. So, I guess, shall I just start over with the thing? Yeah. And not just stop at sprouts, but you let them grow a little more so that they get their first few leaves. Yes. Coming to the nutrition point of microgreens and why you can grow them. So staying in small places, staying in cities or in your balcony, you don't have much place to actually grow vegetables sometimes. So microgreens are one of the best options you can go for because they take less space plus are a power pack of nutrients. In fact, some microgreens, they contain about 60% more vitamin E per gram than the actual leafy vegetable. Vitamin C is like 6 times more than the actual vegetable. And they're packed with antioxidants, they're packed with enzymes, and they're really healthy too. Let me show you what I've grown, actually. These are underway right now. These are mustard microgreens, which is about 4 days old. It's been 4 days since I planted them, and another 2 days to harvest. So basically, they're very quick growing too. So it's very easy to grow at home, and it's very satisfying when you have homegrown veggies to eat, especially something that's so nutritious. Now here I also have fenugreek microgreens growing. I just harvested one batch of mine, so these are still very small. These are pea shoots grown from the green peas that you get in grocery store, the dried ones. And these are Tuor is Arhar pigeon pea. And some of the microgreens I saved from my last harvest, these are pea shoots, the ones you saw right here. These grow into these beautiful little green shoots. And it takes about 7 days, which means they're a very pretty grow them too. Now let me demonstrate to you how we can grow them. So basically there are 3 ways that you can grow microgreens. 3 ways that I'll be showing you. One is using cocopeat as the substrate. One is using a paper towel as the substrate, and one growing them hydroponically in water. Now I'll be using 3 seeds here today. Fenugreek, which I have can be done, still can be done. And some bigger seeds like chickpea, they'll have to be soaked too overnight if you wanna make microgreens out of it. So coming to the materials what I use. I generally go for such kind of mushroom trays. I mean, usually you get mushrooms in these kind of trays and you just dump them in to the, you know, dustbin and they all go for a waste. So this is what I generally take as the base for, I mean, the pot that's going to hold my microgreens. Now, let me just show you. Right. So this is the tray I've taken. Yeah, now first we'll be going to sow fenugreek seeds and using cocopeat. So now I'll be filling this tray with cocopeat about 2 inches. Now this cocopeat I bought online as a brick. You get bricks of cocopeat which you can soak in water to make them you know, as you can see, to get the cocopeat. So what they do is they dry the cocopeat and they compress it to create bricks. And then you mix them with water and they turn into this beautiful brown substrate, which you can use not only for microgreens, but in your plants also. But yes, they hold moisture very well. So these are one of the best substrate that you can use for microgreens. So once you fill up your trays up to, let's say about an inch and a half with the cocopeat, you just press it down lightly, make it all even. Then you take your seeds and you first drain all the water out. You need only the seeds in there. Yes, also, if you can, wash the seeds before you soak them, because sometimes they contain fungal spores or any other bacteria that can cause the entire batch to go bad. So I usually wash them twice with normal water and then soak them in drinking water. So yes, that's the seed. So now we just take the seeds and we spread them all over very evenly. All over the tray. Make sure they're not placed very close to each other, because as the roots start growing, they tend to push each other over. So keep a certain space between each seed, not like clumping them in one space. Spread them very evenly and slightly give them, you know, a little bit of force so that they get embedded into the substrate, so that when you water them, they don't flow around. Yes. So once you're done with that, just take a spray bottle and give it all a nice even spray. Don't make them too moist and make sure you don't give them a wet substrate because they can rot. So now this is, it's this simple. So this is going to be our methi microgreens, fenugreek microgreens, and this is how it looks in 3 days. Now coming to the second method is our paper towel method, wherein we're going to use a paper towel and another tray that we had just used, these ones that come with mushrooms and silicons and other vegetables. So you first fold your paper towel to the proper dimension that's going to fit into this tray. And this method, smaller seeds, because the bolder seeds tend, I mean, they need a little more of substrate that can hold more water and have, and let the roots grow bigger. So yes, once you have folded it to this size, which is perfect for the tray. We just wet the paper towel again using the spray bottle. Let it completely. Yes. So once you have it all moist, for this tray, since we can use only small seeds to grow on paper towel, I'm going to take mustard. So just take the mustard, and as you did with the fenugreek, evenly spread it all over. All over the tray. And in a tray of this size, about 1 gram of mustard seeds can be grown, and it gives you about 35 to 40 gram of mustard greens per tray, which is, and this is in about a week's time. Yes, so that's about it. It's as simple as that. So once this is done, you can, if you feel there's a little less water, like I feel right here, I'm just going to give it another little spray. Yes, that's it. And in 3 days, you'll have something like that. And waiting for another 3 to 4 days, I'll be harvesting them. And probably I'll send the pictures on the garden year group. Coming to the third and the last method that I'll be showing you guys today, the hydroponic method. So for this, you'll be needing a bowl like this. And these kind of containers that you get for, you know, keeping your garlics and onions. So you need something, one of these baskets that fit with, you know, so many holes, lots of holes here. And you need something that fits into this very well. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to fill this up with water, and I'll be having a paper towel layer here, which will be just touching the water surface, so that when the plants start growing the roots get into the water down below, and that will give them all the water they need. So for this, now I'll be taking another paper towel and just folding a little bit near the edges. And place it in there. Now give it a good spray of water just to get the paper towel wet again. And once that's done, it'll look something like that. And you can start filling this up with the seed that you want. Again, since it has no substrate and it's just a paper towel, you might be wanting to plant smaller seeds in this because larger seeds need some more root space. So for larger seeds like chickpea, chana, or green peas, or pigeon peas, it's always better to go for the cocoa peat substrate. So now I have my wheat seeds here that I soaked overnight, overnight, like 8 hours around. So just drain the water, take some of the seeds, and spread it all over the paper towel right here. Make sure that the water in the bowl below stays below the level of the paper towel, but when the roots start growing, the roots should be able to, you know, get into the water pretty soon because you don't want them to run out of water. But if the water level is above the paper towel, then the wheat grass gets, you know, waterlogged kind of a thing, and they start rotting. So once you evenly spread your wheat, it should look something like that. Okay, so now that we have prepared this, our fenugreek and our mustard, for the first 1 or 2 days, till there is like the leaf that is starting to be seen, you'll have to keep them covered. Covering helps them germinate more evenly and, you know, a faster germination. And also, if you can maintain humidity around this, it'll be much better. So what I like doing I take one of these pieces of cardboard with silver lining on one side, and I just cover them just like that. Then you can, you know, stack them up too, just to save more space. That's the second layer. And you know, you make more of them, you can just stack them up like that and keep it in a closet or something for a few days till they start germinating. And once they're about 3 days, that is once they're about this size and you can see the leaves starting to appear, that's when you keep them in sunlight. And you don't keep them in direct sunlight, like very bright sunlight. It just needs a well-lit room, because okay, also the substrate does not need any fertilizer or anything here, because the seed contains all the nutrient that the plant needs. Now we may be wondering, well, if the seed contains all the nutrients that we're going to get, why do we have to grow them to microbeans? Why can't we just eat the seeds? Okay, so the thing is, when a seed contains all the nutrients in a form that can be stored over a long period of time, and they are not easily digested by our digestive system. So what it does when you get them to sprout or germinate like this or grow into microgreens, the plant itself produces enzymes. It starts digesting these nutrients. And now that the nutrients are available in a digestible form, it's easier for us to absorb them too. So that makes these microgreens much more nutritious to us than the seeds themselves. So yes, in a few days, about a week, all of these will have grown into beautiful little microgreens that you can harvest right from your shelves. And you can add them to your salads, you can add them to your dals, you can add them to curries as a garnish. Or if you have enough of them, you can make a curry out of it too. Now, let me show you some pictures that I have that of my previous harvest. Oh, the host. Sahira ma'am, could you allow me to share screen? I guess I'm not able to share my screen.
Yeah, Sahira, just give me a second, Arkesh.
Yeah, sure.
You're the host now, so go ahead and share.
Okay, yeah. Just a minute.
Yeah, share it.
Yeah.
First you have to open in the screen, keep it ready and share it.
Yeah. Right. Is my screen visible?
Yeah, visible.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
So let me just show you the microgreens that I've harvested before. And
these are the wheat grass.
Yes. So these, that's popcorn. I'll be coming to
popcorn,
that name.
Okay.
So yeah, these popcorn are muskmelon microgreens. So usually we don't think we eat muskmelon seeds. Some people just roast the seeds and eat them, but you can also grow them into these beautiful microgreens. So again, the same way as you do with the bigger seeds, use cocopeat as the medium and soak the seeds overnight. And these microgreens grew in 5 days. They're slightly bitter. Some microgreens tend to be bitter, but if you don't keep them in sunlight, just before harvesting, keep them away from sunlight for 6 to 7 hours. And when you harvest them, they'll have reduced their bitterness. Okay, so this is what the fenugreek microgreen looks in 2 days. You can see the roots starting to grow and the seeds are just starting to, sprout out, break through the substrate. So that's in 3 days. That's in 5 days. And this is in 7 days. So in 7 days, you have this beautiful little bunch of microgreens that you can harvest and enjoy. So as you can see here, these are mung microgreens on your left and horse gram microgreens on your right. You get these very nice bunches from each one of these mushroom trays that, one tray is enough for one person for a curry. So having 4 to 5 trays should be enough for your family for a day. So having a good number of them in a cyclic order will give you all the greens you'll need. These are grown from popcorn. So the popcorn you get in your market, just soak them overnight. And using the cocoa state, as you can see, I grow these beautiful little popcorn microgreens, and they're extremely sweet. And they're like very, very sweet. I can't even explain how sweet these are, because popcorn microgreens, I never expected them to be this sweet as such, but they taste like sugar, especially near the roots. So it's a very interesting microgreen to grow. Yeah, that's the harvest I got from one of these trays. So it's a pretty handful from each tray, and it's in a week's time. These are chickpea microgreens, and this is about 4 days old. You can see all of them starting to send out leaves. So in about 7 days, I got that harvest from the microgreens. These are ajwain. Now ajwain or omam, some of these microgreens, they're very small, but the thing I like with ajwain is they add their own flavor to the dish you add. So you can add them as garnishing more than your main leafy green that you're going to use. They're a very nice salad. They add a very ajwaini touch. Yes, and that's tur. Tur that you just, I just showed you. So that's tur, and this also took about 7 to 8 days. Yeah, another thing to make sure with such microgreens is like tur and peas, after a certain growth stage, they start going fibrous, because of course they want to grow into big plants. That's what they want. So they want to get harder and stronger. So they start getting fibrous. So we have to harvest them about in just 7 days, because if you keep them more than 7 days, they start getting fibrous, and it'll be, you know, difficult to chew through them. These are pea shoots, and these are my personal favorites because of their slightly sweet taste, not oversweet, and they're very crunchy, they're very juicy. And these were grown from white peas, and it took about 7 days, and each one of them is about 20 centimeters long in the 7 days, and that's how much I got from one tray. And it was a feast to eat them, make a salad out of them. And yes, that's about it. So I.
Very nice.
I hope that helped you guys get an idea about what microgreens are.
Very good. Very nice.
Arkesh, all this that you have shared, your pictures and your harvest, are an evidence to your passion. Super,
you,
awesome,
yeah,
job, lovely,
very nice.
Lovely harvest, love your,
very
really,
nice. Very nice.
I'm so glad you're a member of the Gardenier community, Arkesh. Wonderful job.
Always good to be a part of
super.
Such a thing.
Now he can add many things in future. This is only beginning.
Yes. Yeah.
Now I'd like to add few things to his presentation. First thing is, remember, all bigger seeds you need to soak 24 hours before you harvest. Example, wheat grains or red beans or rajma, lobia, and peanuts, groundnuts. All you can do the greens, but you need to harvest one day. Rule number one. Rule number two, once the harvest is ready, do not eat them raw. They are very nice to eat, because human gut cannot digest all these on a raw form. Only cattle and sheep can digest, because they can rumificate. They bring them back again. So all this salad business, eating microgreens, it is all myth. Human digestive capability cannot digest them. So you nicely, lightly steam, little bit of vitamin E, C lost, no problem. Eat more. Number two. Number three, soap seeds are very nice to harvest. Because the microgreens, micro growth, what you get out of the soap seeds, soap which you add, it is a very, very nice sweet flavor. You can even, you know, chew them. Very nice they are. And they are very soft to digest. And ideally, you should not expose them to sun. We are basically eating them before chlorophyll starts acting. We are eating them before all the, even wheat grass, you are supposed to eat before really chlorophyll settles down there. So that once chlorophyll settles down, it will become bitter and the hard fiber will increase. We cannot digest them very, very. Basically, we are trying to digest soft fiber. And in a hydroponic, there is a danger of mosquitoes because mosquitoes grow in 3 to 4 days. If you are not, you need to change water every day, the lower patila, what he has shown, steel one. Or if you're using a NPK, 1 gram in 1 liter, you can change that water once in 15 days because NPK itself doesn't allow bacteria to, even mosquitoes larva to grow. But the effect goes around 12 to 13 days. So if you're using any micronutrient in the water, because after all the roots are hanging in the water, so you need to change every 15 days. Or if you're not adding any nutrient to water alone can give nutrient to hydroponic plants, but you need to change every day. Okay, this is very important. And flaxseed microgreens are very good for health because they are very rich in omega-3 fatty acids. Commercially grown flax seeds, first soak few hours, and then he has shown very nicely 3 methodologies. You can use a cloth also, very sterile, you know, boil your towel or small hand towel in a boil, moist, instead of a tissue paper you can put. Tissue paper is very easy to do it. Okay, otherwise he has covered mostly, very nice presentation and it was very crisp, easy to follow. Okay, I think some of the questions I kept on typing, answering them back. Yeah, otherwise it's a wonderful session. Over to Saira.
Yeah, actually a doctor has to leave, I think in another few minutes, that's the reason he came in between. So Arkesh, I think you can take over. And yeah, if you're done, we are open to questions in case the attendees have any questions, done. Please go ahead and ask. You can unmute yourself and ask.
Can I ask Sahira?
Yeah.
Can I ask Sahira?
Ask fast.
Please ask. It's all yours.
Sir, Arikesh and Bhaktiyar, sir, both of you have done a great job explaining microgreens. That was one field which I was very apprehensive about. Somehow I couldn't practice that. But today's workshop actually gave lots of clarity. What are the beginning seeds which can be done without any mess and easily? Can you please give a list of those seeds? Because I don't want to try with complicated things and disappoint myself.
Yeah, Arikesh, tell.
Firstly, I would say microgreens in themselves are a very messless method because we're not using soil as much. We're using this coco peat, which doesn't create dirt around much. But yeah, going to very simple seeds that you can use, I would say mustard is easy. Sesame seeds are easy. You can start with the peas. You can start with moong, green gram. You can start with fenugreek. And as Swar said, even saumph and ajwain, they grow very well too. So yeah, these should be a few seeds. And yeah, I guess experimenting and trying new things and failing once or twice is the basic thing on how you're going to learn.
For starters, best is dhania. You know,
coriander,
dhania is a, coriander is a wonderful. And moong sprouts are very common, we do, and we eat them also. These are very, very edible form. You start with the moong and coriander and soap. Once you succeed with this, go for a bigger grains.
Okay, sir. How long should dhania be soaked, sir? Because dhania have failed multiple times in soil.
No. So first thing is dhania you have to break.
Okay.
Because whole dhania will take long time. Just rub it, crush it. They should become 50-50, small boats, they should become 50-50. Then only because otherwise it's a hard wood. So you just crush, you know, koncham danchal dhaniyani. Then after that, you don't need to really soak them. You put straight away on a tissue or a, as is shown. It doesn't need big soaking.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
The best That's technique, ma'am, the best technique for dhania is just to, you know, rub it, crush it with your slipper. They get split into two very easily. That's the easiest and very useful technique that we have been adopting.
But they get coronavirus through slipper. Be careful.
Yeah.
Use a new one. Balan. They don't get spoiled actually. Seeds are very small. So you crush with the balloon also, you know?
Sure.
Nothing will
sure.
happen. Yeah.
Sure, sir. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Hello. Hi, sir. I'm Adya. Hello. Can I ask? Is it audible?
Ask, please, please.
సార్ ఇది ధనియాలు చెప్పినట్టే ఇంకా వేరే సీడ్స్ ఏదైనా కేర్ తీసుకోవాలా ఎనీ అదర్ సీడ్స్ విచ్ నీడ్ నాట్ బి సోక్డ్ అండ్ యునో క్రస్ట్ లైక్ దట్ ఫర్ ఎగ్జాంపుల్ ఇప్పుడు ధనియా చెప్పారు కదా ఎనీ అదర్ సీడ్స్
స్మాల్ స్మాల్ సీడ్స్ డోంట్ రిక్వైర్ టూ మచ్ ఆఫ్ సోకింగ్ లైక్ మెంతి సీడ్స్ ఆర్ హార్డ్ హార్డ్ సీడ్స్ నీడ్ లిటిల్ బిట్ సోకింగ్ యునో ఫెనుగ్రీక్ సీడ్స్ రిక్వైర్ సీడింగ్ మోస్ట్లీ వీట్ దే నీడ్ కంప్లీట్లీ 24 అవర్స్ ఆఫ్ సోకింగ్ డోంట్ పుట్ వీట్ అదర్వైజ్ ఇట్ విల్ టేక్ లాంగ్ టైమ్ The more time, the more the fungus attacks. You remember, the more longer period you do, you will be contaminating. It will have fine fungus, you will not notice. And instead of vitamin E and C, you get aspergillosis. So fungal infection. And don't repeatedly use the same tissue paper. Even cocopeat, take 2 or 3 harvesting and remove it. See the quality. That is very important. Hygiene is very, very important. And a lot of people have fungal problems. I give you a simple thing. You take dalchini, you know, cinnamon bark, powder it and add it in water. Little bit sprinkle. It will function like your antifungal because you cannot add a saff or other Milton or other antifungal because you are going to consume. No chemical antifungals in this. You add only natural antifungals. That is a curcumin. That is, haldi powder. You know, you can add turmeric powder, little bit, sprinkle it. Or you can have a dalchini, that is a cinnamon powder. Or in a worst scenario, the commonly hanging plant, everybody's house nowadays. What is that? Everybody's house is hanging nowadays. You're using medicine out of that guju.
Aloe vera.
Yes. Cut the aloe vera. Take little bit aloe vera. Mix it in water. Sprinkle it. These are all organic antifungal, aloe vera, turmeric, and cinnamon. So you don't have to really fear about fungal infection, and you don't never use any antifungal material in greens. Arkesh, you must tell first sentence because they read a lot about saff and other antifungal. People tend to use. Okay. Yeah. I think that clears.
Yeah, there's one more
question.
There are two more antifungals that I like to use. One is onion peel tea, which is basically just onion peels that soaked in water again for overnight or 24 hours. And the other one is just a little bit of apple cider vinegar sometimes. A light spraying.
Where is the apple cider, man? Don't tell about apple cider in India because you have to buy commercially. Onion peels, they stink. So these two are a reserved things. So first three are the good. Good.
So, okay? Sir, one more question.
Yes, Adya, tell me.
Yeah, sir, it's a maximum time is like 1 week as discussed, right?
Peanuts takes 3 weeks. If you want to put a groundnut, peanuts, bigger seed, they may take longer time. Wheatgrass take from 3 days, you can harvest up to 7 days. That's why when you do wheatgrass, you have to use many containers at a time. Today, one container, tomorrow, 7 days cycle it is. So, seventh day, your first tray is ready for harvest. Remember?
Okay.
So, wheatgrass grows for ready to harvest 7 days. So, you need to make 7 days so that you get every day one harvest. By the time seventh day is over, first day, your wheatgrass is ready. These are the secrets of getting recurrent harvest. Otherwise, one tray is over, you get tired, you'll throw it.
Correct.
Okay. I think we completed.
I think we will disconnect in 3 minutes. So if you would like to join back, use the same link and join back. We'll have Arkesh here. It will be gone, but Arkesh will remain here.
Okay. Anyway, bye-bye. I am not joining you. I am going on another meeting. Okay. Very, very well done. I think you should try with one tray, just an experiment. And definitely use wheatgrass because wheatgrass has the maximum vitamin E, C, and it can increase your hemoglobin, especially women, dramatically. We have tried for athletes, players. So wheatgrass is a very, very super. And dhania, hara dhania is most common. So you can get repeated. Okay. Congratulations, Arkesh. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you.
All members of Green Yar. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you, doctor. Yeah, Arkesh, go ahead.
Yes. Any more questions?
Yeah, would anybody like to ask questions? Please unmute yourself and ask questions.
Hello.
Yes, go ahead, ma'am.
Hello, everyone. This is Amina from Hyderabad. One basic thing I want to know is, Arkesh, can you hear me?
Yes, yes, I can hear you.
Yeah, you're audible, Amina.
Okay, see, what I want to ask is, Kalonji and onion seeds, are they both same and can we use them to germinate? Will sprouting happen? I was thinking about it, but I did not experiment.
Well, yes, sprouting does occur and that is used to grow microgreens, but sometimes the one you get in the market, you might not be able to grow them into the fully grown plants, like the fully grown onions. But yes, for microgreens, yes, they do grow very well. And they do have the taste and smell of spring onions. So just as a garnish, you can use them. Yeah. It's the same thing. You can grow them as you grow your mustard, which basically means you might not have to soak them much. Yeah, the tissue technique you can use. Just make sure you keep it covered and keep it humid inside. Yeah.
Okay, I definitely don't let them dry out. Okay, and also I want to know how to grow parsley. Do we get seeds or how? I mean, it's a rare herb in India, I think, right? But due to its many medicinal properties.
Yeah, right. It's very similar like coriander to grow. Just the thing is, like, they're bigger plants. So they need bigger space. There is more nutrients, more space in the soil and more sunlight. But yeah, the growing is very similar. The seeds look similar. Uh-huh. So, yeah, you just have to crush them, split them open and put them directly in the soil. Or you can soak them, but not too much.
So it's easily available here, like in the shops?
Online, a few shops you get, but I haven't seen them as common in the nurseries that you can go personally to.
Okay.
Yeah.
And one last thing, the use of microgreens, as you said. Yes. Hello. I'm Amina.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
Okay. One last question. The usage of microgreens can be done raw as well as can be added in curries, right? So, if we add it in hot curries, will its nutritive value decrease, or will it remain the same?
Well, just like normal vegetables, you shouldn't overcook them. But yes, cooking them makes it more digestible for us, as the doctor said before. You can use them in salads, but they won't be digested as much. Though we might get a few nutrients here and there, but if you slightly cook them, they're more digestible. But yeah, for getting something, we have to give up a few things. Not like it's going to be less nutritious, they'll be the same. Mm-hmm. But yeah, just don't overcook them.
Okay. I think it's better to add in the last, right?
Yeah, somewhere around the end, like when you add your coriander leaves usually.
Okay.
I have a question. The wheat germ, does it also need to be steamed before consuming it?
You mean the wheat grass?
Yeah, wheat grass. Yeah.
Wheat grass, they generally, you know, make juices out of it because you don't usually add it in your curries. What they do is they take the raw greens, harvest it, they blend it in a blender like you would juice any other vegetable or any fruit, and then you just mix it with something else or have it raw. In fact, I remember making my mom making a jaljeera out of it, which tasted really nice. So you make a normal jaljeera, whatever you make, and you just blend your wheatgrass into a very fine paste or, you know, a juice. And you mix it together. That makes a really nice energizing drink.
Okay, thank you. And very good session. Very good session.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Yeah, any more questions? From anyone? Since we have come back, I think we have time now. Any online sites recommendations for CocoPeat? CocoPeat is available in all the nurseries, Swati.
Where does one buy these trays?
I get these when we buy mushrooms, like from the grocery store. You get mushrooms in these trays. So it's okay. Those trays I'm reusing. But otherwise, you get trays for microgreens itself. They're like bigger trays and more sturdy ones that you can reuse with drainage holes and stuff. But yeah, I find these usable as the same. So they're the same amount of efficient. You just need a container. And you don't need to have these trays. You can have any other flat container.
Yeah.
Maybe even sometimes what I do, if there's a tall plant growing in one of my pots, so the area below it remains free and the tall plant, the roots go very deep. So the top layer of soil, I just sprinkle some seeds there and they grow like microgreens there for a while. So then you can harvest them. So you're not wasting any space in pots too.
Okay.
Arkesh, someone would like to know what is the frequency of watering?
The frequency of watering. Okay, so when you're using the paper towel method, it tends to hold less water, so it dries up very quickly too. So that you might have to water twice a day, you know, once in the morning, once in the evening. If it, just make sure it doesn't go dry. It has to remain moist all the time, because if the roots dry up, then your plant might not be able to, you know, jump back to how it was before. Cocopeat, since it's a little thicker, plus it retains more moisture, once a day should be fine with it. But yeah, don't overwater, don't let it soak in water, and don't let it dry up. As soon as you see even the top layer slightly turning, you know, less moist, just spray water. Yeah.
Okay.
Hi, Arkesh. It's been a wonderful session. Thank you so much. So much. I was always confused about nutritional values of sprouts and microgreens, but now I'm very clear about it rather than reading up somewhere else. And the second thing, I have tried growing microgreens in masonry jars with perforated lid. So just soak them for like half a day and just drain them, you know, just ulta it and drain them. And rinse it twice or thrice a day. So the moisture content is intact. And I have got great results with alfalfa sprouts, alfalfa, and broccoli and clover. Awesome.
Oh, beautiful.
Thank you so much.
Alfalfa, I would like to try. I haven't tried alfalfa yet. Never got to get the seeds in here. But yeah, I want to definitely try that from there.
Yeah, they're awesome. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
Any last minute points, Arkesh, from you? Do's, don'ts?
More than do's, don'ts, I would say do the don'ts, because I learned most of my stuff making mistakes, because like my first few trays just completely rotted. And especially when you have microgreens, even if there's, since it's a small tray and since they're all small plants, even if a few plants in the corner start rotting, it just spreads very quickly. So like within a day, your whole tray is gone sometimes. So just looking back to what you might have done wrong for this batch, helps you learn what not to do for the next batch. So don't give up on one or two trays. Just keep trying. Try experimenting new methods, because we always keep improving as in how we, you know, keep experimenting and keep trying again and again. But yeah, in case there's any kind of infection in one corner or something, just clear out the entire area, like leaving a little more too. So if I see there's a plant that's rotting here, for example, I'm going to take out the entire quarter of this out and try keeping it away from the rest of the plants. That's your best way you can try saving those plants. But otherwise, yeah, just look back on what you might have done wrong or where might have it gone wrong, and don't reuse that cocopeat again if there's disease in that once. Always start with the new fresh batch. And the old cocopeat, once you have harvested like twice or thrice, it can always go into your compost as an additive.
I have a question. I have a bougainvillea and mango growing in big pots. So in that, can I put these small seeds and like, because it takes just six, seven days to, and I can harvest?
Yeah, you can definitely do that. Unless there's roots of the plant that's growing near the soil. Like if the roots of the mango and bougainvillea are going really deep and not staying much at the surface, then you can definitely plant them around. So if like the top 2 inches or 3 inches are free of the roots of the main plant, you can definitely add these there. So like you're not leaving any space around. And it keeps, and it actually benefits the main plant too, because these plants prevent excessive evaporation from the soil. So it acts like a living mulch for your plant around.
Okay.
Farida ma'am, this is that's actually a very good idea. When you don't have space and you have few plants which are potted in big pots, that's the best way to grow. Actually, my son has done this many times. Even my mom does this regularly because she has no space. She throws all the methi seeds and coriander seeds around her, you know, jasmine plants and the bougainvilleas and all the other potted plants, and they come very well. In fact, we've had 3-4 harvests of these kind of methi and other things grown around a bigger plant. So I think you can do. Plants cooperate actually. If you give them little space, they do. Yeah. Arkesh, I have a request. If you, because you have been experimenting various things in this area, as and when you find new learnings, new techniques, please do share on Garden Yard for the benefit of the members of the community. Okay. It was, I don't see any more questions coming up from the attendees. Superb job, Arkesh. So proud of you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for all the effort you have put in, you know, really growing and harvesting, just to show them here your demo of the three techniques, the lovely presentation you have made with those awesome pictures in them. Awesome. I mean, true dedication and passion was evident in this session. I'm so happy that I invited you for this session. We'll look for more opportunities to call you back on this webinar.
Yes, I'll be looking forward to.
Sure. Thank you so much. And I envy the green corner that you have.
One question.
Yeah.
I see one question I just have missed. The question says, do we eat the whole plant or only the top? Yes. So you only eat the top of the plant. Top in the sense you can cut it above 2 millimeters from the ground level. Do not eat below that, because there might be, I mean, there's always a chance to have some kind of fungus or anything, microbes growing there. So yes, cut the plant, if you can see that. So the plant was growing at this height. So you like leave the bottom part and you cut the plant right there. And especially if your plants like chickpea or peas, they can be harvested multiple times from the same seed. So if you leave the bottommost node of the plant and you harvest the tips, they grow more branches. So you can have about 3 harvests from the same tray before you'll have to change the seeds again.
Super.
Chickpea and one more. What was the one more seed?
Oh, chickpeas. That's your chana and your green peas.
Green peas. Okay.
Yes. So these can be harvested multiple times, just if you leave the bottommost node on the plant.
And how about the popcorn ones you have grown? How to use them?
Popcorn ones, well, I just ate them raw because they were too sweet to be used in anything. So I haven't found a use for them yet. They're very sweet. I can't explain how sweet.
Sir was saying don't eat raw. Does that apply here?
Yeah, that's because that does apply. Because see, cooking makes it more digestible to us. So you won't be getting all the nutrients as much as you can if you slightly cook them, but yeah, as a garnish to salads here and there, somewhat, yeah, they do add into the taste.
Yeah, I think coriander and all, you can just, yeah, Arkesh, I think coriander and all doesn't need any kind, but the others, it is definitely better to semi boil them just for few minutes in a microwave or something.
Boil them
is definitely good,
especially
for the cut.
Chickpeas and pigeon peas, it's always best to semi cook them, like not overcook, but just so that they get softer.
Easy to digest.
So most of them take either 3 to 4 days or max 1 week. Most of them, right?
I would say 7 days and more. 7 days and more. Yeah.
Yeah. That's good, because most of them you were mentioning were like within a week, like wheatgrass, then most of them. Like coriander also 1 week. Is it like more?
Coriander can be harvested in 1 week, but you can let them grow into coriander. So if you want them as microgreens, see what I do for coriander, I plant them very densely. And I start harvesting a few as microgreens and I let a few grow bigger. Then I harvest them more. So by the end, when you have a few plants here and there, I let them grow to the full size so that you have multiple stages. It's like basically like how you do thinning of plants. So you start with a lot of plants and as you go along, you remove a few of them, making space for the remaining of them to grow into bigger plants. So you start as microgreens and remove a few plants here and there, harvest them as microgreens, and the remaining will grow into bigger plants, which you can harvest as coriander itself.
So the whole process takes around 2 weeks, might be?
For coriander, a little more than 2 weeks for the biggest plant. But as microgreens, yeah, you can harvest them within 1.5 week after they germinate, because coriander can take up to 3 days to germinate.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Thank you.
Something like chickpeas and green peas, right? It was same as chickpeas and green peas. Yeah, and even coriander can be the same.
Yeah, the same.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you, Arkesh. It is really like wonderful session.
Thank you. You have given very good tips. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Oh, there's one question again. Can we also try chili seeds?
No. Okay. So never eat any plant from Solanaceae family. That includes your chilies, tomatoes, potatoes, capsicum. Never eat any brinjal also. Never eat any of the leaves, and never try microgreens with them because they're poisonous and they can cause a lot of issues. They're toxic. So always go for either cereals or pulses, or you can also go to the carrot family, that is Apiaceae, your carrot, coriander, ajwain, fennel, saum, and all of that. Or you can also go for some like from the Asteraceae family, which is your sunflower seeds. You can also go for lettuce seeds. So yeah, those seeds are usually better to go for. Never Solanaceae. Tomato, chili, capsicum should never be eaten.
Thank you, Swati, for that question.
Yes. Thank you for
that question. When do you think is the ideal duration before harvesting mustard using the paper tissue method?
6 to 7 days. You'll see both of the leaves that are, I don't know if it will be clear if I show this. So each plant right here has two leaves on them, which are both lobed, bilobed leaves. So when those two leaves grow big and they start separating, letting space for one more leaf to come from the middle, that's when you harvest them. Because after that, they'll be needing soil to grow because it will have depleted the seed reserve of nutrients. So once the seed leaves, start separating apart and you have your true leaves coming up, that's when you harvest your microgreens. And this is applicable for almost all the plants.
One question. Can we just cut it, leaving the roots inside, and just chop the top part and use it for consumption? Or do we need to pull it out of the soil?
You don't have to pull it out of the soil. You can just chop off the portion, and that's how you harvest microgreens. You chop off the top portions, leaving about 2 millimeter space from the soil. So yeah. Leave the bottom 2 millimeters there. You chop off the rest of it. And if you are able to pull out the roots and get clean coco peat back, which is not having any fungus or something, you can reuse them. Or you can take the entire cake kind of thing that forms because of the network of roots. You can compost it directly.
Ah, okay.
Yeah.
The roots get composted as well.
One more question. How to know whether the like coco peat is like good or it's like spoiled kind of thing? Any indications or like... Oh,
your
something.
Good coco peat will always be very dark in color, and it'll be it separates from each other. The particles are very separate and loose. So if
maybe
you generally
porous.
Have a mold, very porous and they're very loose. I mean, it breaks apart very easily. They don't clot together. So if there's a fungal growth or something, they tend to form clots, or they can go very smushy and soft. So this is, it should look something like it's dark in color. So when it's too dry, it gets either like a light brown, or when it has mold in it, you might slowly get tinges of yellowish liquid from it, which is due to the fungal spores. Basically it should be very porous, very soft, and when you let it to dry, it should dry very fast. So that's how I check my coco peat too.
Coco peat. Okay.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Yeah, I guess we can call it a day, Arkesh. Yeah, very, very informative session. Very informative. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Very nice.
Yeah, thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Thanks a lot for your time. And thank you again, Arkesh.
Thank you so much.
So I think if you have further questions, you can always join the group and post your questions there. We'll give you the answers there, because Arkesh is a part of our gardener community, so he can answer your queries on these things even later on.
Saira, you can add me there.
Adya, okay, I will add your name. Yes, I will add your name.
Thank you so much. Actually, good questions came out in the last moment. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. Good night, everyone. Thank you, Arkesh. Good night. Stay safe. Thank you.
Good night.